first call the meeting to order at 6:03.
I introduce.
Everybody?
Yeah, it's up to you.
Okay.
It's kind of laborious.
All right, well, okay. I'm Elaine Campbell, Chair of the Conway School Committee.
Jan Warner, Conway School Committee.
Kristen Gordon, Principal of Conway.
Patty Kavanaugh, Director of Business Services.
Dr. Carey, Superintendent.
Ira Band, School Committee.
Phil Cantor, School Committee.
All righty, first order of business is approval of minutes from December 15th meeting. Can I have any feedback, any corrections?
There's Ashley.
Will we accept the minutes of December 15th?
Can I have a second?
Yes.
All right, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. And do we want to go right on to financial statement?
Okay, I'm ready.
All right.
So tonight you have 6 warrants to sign, totaling $49,751.38. I do want to bring to your attention on page 2 of the financial report, which I did bring hard copies for you tonight, because I do apologize that I didn't get this emailed out until today. I will do my best next month to get it to you earlier. On page 2, our salaries for special education aides is showing a deficit of $13,000 due to a student's IEP. Had to bring a new IA on to support that. And that's why we're over, and I will be working with Principal Kristen to make sure that we adjust some other lines and find some savings to cover that shortfall.
So is that a re-eval or a new eval that required the change?
It was a change in placement for the student.
Oh, okay.
So it was through a team meeting.
Oh.
I do want to let you know that the warrant articles were submitted to the town, and I was going to bring you copies, and I
can't work the copier.
I can't work the new copier.
I do have one.
I will email you a copy of what was sent to the town. So there was 2 requests that were sent to the town. The first one was to request the $50,000 to the school stabilization fund. And the second request was at a special town meeting or the next annual town meeting that the school committee desired to withdraw $35,000 for the projects, and we listed them out. Not by dollar amounts, just the projects that we were going to be working on. So the town administrator has those, and he's going to put them forward to the capital plan, and then hopefully capital committee, and then go to the warrant. But I will send you out what was
submitted. A third warrant? That was for to free up the money that for central office move? Or
yes, that was submitted previously. There is a warrant article that was submitted from Frontier. Several years ago, there was money requested from the town to do some repairs at the central office at 219 Christian. Money remaining, and we want to use those funds to put air conditioning in the new offices at the high school. So there is a warrant article requesting to be able to reuse those funds at the new offices. So that was submitted back in September, I believe. The only other thing I have for you tonight before we look at the budget is we have our preliminary school choice numbers, and I gave you a report that's 3 pages. And the first page is our receiving report. These are children who are coming to Conway Grammar School from other towns. And we are up 5 from our June number. In June, we had 20 students, and the FTE was 19.21, which means one student wasn't here the entire year. They either came late or they left early. Right now, we have 25 students. And right below that, you'll see that they're coming from this year, Buckland and Charlemont, Coleraine, Deerfield, Greenfield, Montague, Orange, Shelburne Falls, South Hadley, Waitley, and Williamsburg is the total for the 25. Below that, I've summarized for you the grade levels that they're attending.
And so when you see the net change, I am comparing the FY17 first grade to the FY16 kindergarten. So it's not, I'm not comparing first grade to first grade. I am comparing first grade to last year was kindergarten.
Oh, that's good.
Okay, so you're seeing at the grade, you know, how many kids stayed with us or how many kids joined us. So right now, preliminarily, it looks like for this fiscal year, we will have about $171,814. What could change that is if any of the 25 do not stay for the full year, or if any of the students that we did not have last year have a sped increment, because they can't calculate that in December because we don't report the sped increment until June reporting. So it could, if any of our student school choice students are receiving sped services, we do put the increment, the cost of those services on the school choice claim form, which will happen in June. If we look at the second page, these are the Conway students that are choosing out of our district, and we've stayed basically the same. Last year there was 11, and this year there's 11. So the town is responsible for the preliminary number of $89,021, which is up $1,828. And where our students are choosing to is Deerfield, Hatfield, Leverett, Mohawk Trail, Northampton, Sunderland, and Whately. And again, below are the school choice grade levels that they're at this year and last. And the last page is our charter students, Conway residents who are chartering out, and we are down one. Last year there was 3 going to charter, and this year there's 2. I don't think that third one doesn't mean that they're not still in charter. They just went to the 7th grade, so they're probably still in a charter school, but they get reported on Frontier. And just so that you know, I will take the rosters of the choice and charter out. And what I do is I will send those names to the town clerk here in Conway to verify that they are still residents, so that Conway is not charged for people who may have moved to another community. So I do verify with our town clerks that they are still residents.
That's a good idea.
So that's the report I have on school choice and charter. If you have any questions regarding that or the financial statement, I'll try to entertain them.
Any questions or discussion?
No, that increase in school choice is, yeah, that should help. A little tiny bit.
Mm-hmm. Are we advertising? Like for school choice? You know, you hear Greenfield on the radio all the time, the superintendent of Greenfield.
I've gotten about 4 calls for next year. Huh. And my understanding, at least this is what I think the process is, that you vote on the numbers and then we can start accepting.
Mm-hmm.
But maybe can't do that until the budget.
Right. Usually it happens in April. I think Greenfield, you know, they might.
It's like they're on a PR campaign. Yeah. That's.
I think they need a little. But I will say our exciting news, of course, is that we are going to full day preschool, pre-K, for our 3-year-olds and 4-year-olds. And that's...
You mean full week?
Full week.
Yeah.
Full week. And we will also have aftercare for parents that work till 5:36. So, I think till 5:30, I'm sorry. But we will have, the goal is to have a licensed person, you know, from 3 o'clock until 5 or 5:30, so that it'll be more, we'll have a more accountability there. So we'll have someone with an associate's degree that has a degree in early childhood ed. So when those children stay after school, if they need that extra daycare piece, it'll be covered with, you know, some more standards in place. So we are having 5 days next year, and it's exciting for us. All schools in the Union 38 will now have full day. And
Five full days in all 4 schools?
So one school we have 5 days, but it's half It's happening. So I keep saying full day in that school, but this school, it's been full day, but only 4 days. Now it's 5 days full day everywhere. If you live anywhere and you have a 3-year-old and a 4-year-old, and anywhere in Union 38, you are welcome to bring that child to our school.
That's great.
That is great. So is tuition going up as well?
That's under review.
It's under review at this point. However, I have to be honest with you, the quality of our program is so exceptional. Kim McCarthy, she does a fantastic job. And of course, Sue here has been phenomenal for years. The quality is just there, and the fact that we can offer it for more students. You know, we feel that hopefully we'll get some more, a few more, because I think it's hard for parents to, you know, to 4 days on, 1 day off, that kind of thing. So I'm very excited. Our youngest students, intervention is so important at that age.
So you think that there's people out there that just are using daycare that will be coming in for an organized preschool?
I do. That's the hope.
They say the fourth, not having it the fifth day is the reason they can't set up.
That's why we started at Montessori's.
Right.
Yeah.
That fifth day's hard.
Sometimes when you have daycare, they make you pay even if you're not there.
Mm-hmm.
And so if you're only going on a Friday, you're losing money as opposed to paying tuition. Here, it'd be the same as paying daycare, but you need the qualities.
Mm.
So I'm very excited for us. I'm excited for Union 38, but I'm especially excited for Conway.
That's awesome.
We have such beautiful children.
We?
I'm not biased.
As opposed to the neighboring towns that have such ugly children.
I come in and there's
porcelain
two little
dolls.
Girls I look at. One is a little tiny blonde darling, and the other one, to me, looks like a Campbell kid.
Gotta love those Campbell kids.
I just come in and look at them. We're really blessed. Conway has beautiful children. I know.
We do.
Every school does. Every child is beautiful. Mm-hmm. There's no doubt about it. I just love coming here and looking at the children. And I'm excited about Monday morning. All school sing along at 9 a.m.
Yes, yay. Yes.
So that's going to be another exciting moment in our
pre-K in it.
I don't know, they sat right in front of me.
Oh my God, they were so cute.
Weren't they great?
I'll
go in and I'll just, Lynn comes over, I'm like, let's go see preschool.
Just stand there and look.
They are really super cute.
So anyway,
it's a good substitute for like puppy and cat videos.
Oh, you're not kidding. They really could be therapy children, you know what I mean?
Yeah, but we're going to add them to our wellness plan, we decided.
There you go.
They are. So I'm really excited for us. And Sue is great. Sue McRae, she's on board, you know, on board. It's the best for kids, and it's the best thing we can offer. I'm really excited. It's a great improvement.
Awesome.
But just going back to the school choice issue, I think when you look at our overall enrollment and you see that it's tailing off, you know, that the K through 4 are all under 20.
Right, so the thought is to open it up to 20, so it would be like 4 or 3 or whatever. Yeah, that would be a recommendation that I have as principal, yeah.
So I mean, I hope when they're calling that we're being encouraging.
Lynn and I have been saying, well, we can't completely guarantee because of school, mm-hmm. but... You're on the list, you know.
We've
sort of been giving them.
Good.
Yes, I met with a wonderful mom early on 2 weeks ago, and just a great conversation, and it was a very nice conversation. Yeah, you're right on top of the list. You know, you're right on, you know. So people, they love the school. They just love it.
It's great.
I think you love it.
Awesome. And no public for comment, so we don't have unfinished business, correct?
Correct.
We finished all our business. So we're on to new business. So one is the February school committee date. We need to vote on moving it, is that right?
Yeah.
So it's because it's during vacation. So it's the 23rd, so we want to move it to the 16th? Okay. Can I get a motion for that?
Motion.
Second?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Thank you.
All righty. So February 16th. All right, and on
is that going to be a budget? Are we going to have a preliminary budget then?
You have one now.
Yes.
Budget. On to the budget.
Oh, I'm still checking up on the 16th. I'm still writing that out. So we are presenting the budget, and what I really want to say before we, you know, we really get into it, Patty will go over the pluses and the minuses and how it's going to work out, but I do want to say when we look at the budget, the very first page has the goals in it, and the goals, the reason why we have the goals on this page, and this is, and Patty will tell you, this is something I brought with me from my previous job as an assistant superintendent, but these goals, everything we do should relate back to these goals, and these goals are all about the kids. And I think I'm preaching to the choir in Conway, so I won't need to really go into it, but everything we do, as we talk to the money, is about the kids. It's that's why we're here. And, but I think that you understand that. And so I'll go. The school's great. It's a wonderful, wonderful school. All the systems that we have in place, the people, the staff, the children, and so when we talk about the money, it's really about what's best for the kids and maintaining the reputation we have and what we do. So thanks, Patty.
Okay, so our first page is our cover page, and then we have our school committee page, and then page, the first one I start numbering, one of 23. We're calling this our student and staff data sheet. As Dr. Carey said, we have the goals, and goal 4 was in here. It seems to have gotten scrunched, so I got to pull that out. It's there. I think I just have to make this text box bigger. So on the left, we look at our current enrollment based on our October 1st census that we filed with the state. So we had 141 children, 26 on IEPs. And then we're projecting that into 2018. Now, right now in kindergarten, it says 3. And the reason it says 3 is because that's how many early pre-K kids we know are coming up. So we're not saying we only have 3 children. We're in the middle of kindergarten enrollment right now, so this number will be ever evolving as our kindergarten enrollment does. But we knew there were 3 in pre-K moving up to K, so that's why it says 3. On the right hand, we talk about our staff and what the FTEs are in each category. And as you can see right now, I'm showing that one IA that we spoke about earlier in the financial report. So last year we had 35.8 staff, and this year we have 36.8. Below that, we summarized the teacher credentials. So we have 3 of our professional staff with bachelor's degrees, 2 with bachelor's 15, 8 have master's, 3 have master's 15, 2 have master's 30, and 5 staff members have their master's, CAGs, or doctorate. Page 2 of 23.
Stop hiring so many smart people.
I hear that teachers don't leave Conway, they retire from Conway.
I was joking. Smart people are great to hire.
So page 2 of 3 is our summary of changes pages, and this is just showing where we start. We start with this year's budget of $1,792,630. We have step raises because of our collective bargaining agreement. They total $6,484. The negotiated rate for the collective bargaining agreement is 2.5% in FY18. That's adding $27,090 to our budget. Degree changes, $4,981. Longevity, we have 2 people new to the longevity schedule, totaling $500. The lead teacher stipend in the last contract was increased, so we need to increase that by $1,100. We did have a staff member retire last year after the cutoff point, so we do have a retirement buyback in the amount of $3,226. We're setting aside $4,000 for the non-union salary increases, which we usually bring to you in May. And then the addition of the, the addition of the instructional assistant, $27,371. Other operational increases, $50, that's the IAPD money. School committee increase, $965. The school committee belongs to the Collaborative for Educational Services. This $965 was being paid from a grant that it's not, we shouldn't be paying it from a grant, so we need to add it to the budget. The principal has increased, requested an increase for the postage increase for $188. We have reshuffled our deck with our building and classroom softwares, and it increased $2,971. If you remember the first year that Scott Paul was with us, he focused on our hardware. So now we've spent this year focusing on what are the softwares that everybody has and are we budgeting for them. So we have this very elaborate spreadsheet. All softwares are present and accounted for, and that's going to increase the budget by $2,971. We're asking for a modest increase of $1,122 for instructional and supplies and general supplies. And Conway is also going to see a decrease in the central office percentage of 10.71 down to 10.14, so that'll be a savings of $3,271. And I do want to explain that even though it's a decrease from last year, there have been some changes to the central office budget in that we've had two staff members who were partially funded by grants, and we've lost that grant funding. So their salaries had to increase to the central office budget. And also when we made the change from Redeker to Power School, there was a decision made that there was to be one district-wide data person. So that position has also been added. There was also some savings from closing Christian Lane, and they're conservative estimates, and they'll probably flesh out more in FY19, but not having any experience of what you use for heat in an empty building, we played it safe, so we'll probably have another reduction the following year. So that increases our budget by $76,777, or 4.28%, bringing the total budget request to the town to $1,869,407. So if you turn the page, the pages 3 through 11 are the detail for the town appropriation request that I just summarized for you. So you can look at that. And then starting on page 12, we're looking at all our costs and funds for the year by looking at all our funding sources. So here you see what we're going to be doing for school choice, our early childhood revolving, our SPED revolving, Title I, and our federal 94-142 grant, the IDEA grant, which Betsy DeVos did not know was a federal law that the states couldn't decide to follow or not.
Just saying.
So if you go to the last page of that series, which is page 20 of 23. We will be, as I said, requesting from the town the $1,869,000, but that represents about 81% of the total funds that we will be expending. And $143,403 will come from school choice, $25,000 from the early childhood revolving, $250,392 from the SPED revolving, $10,073 for Title I, and $24,074 from the SPED grant, for a total of
$2,322,349. What's Title I?
Title I pays for partial of our reading specialist here in the building. That's what we're using the Title I's for.
That's federal?
Yes.
Yes. It's actually over 50 years old.
Title I, No Child Left Behind. No.
That's the one that they're going to convert to direct cash voucher payments to all parents.
Could be.
This is part of the civil, you know, civil rights from the 60s. It was the early, the very first, before we had, it was the Not Every Child Succeeds Act, but way before the Education Improvement Act in the 60s. Johnson was the one that put it in. And it really is to help students, A, who are living in poverty, but also students who are having trouble catching up. So when we say the reading specialist, she generally works with those students who are just, they have some kind of, they cannot attain the same learning and reading as in math skills as students can in the classroom. So they need that little one-on-one type of thing.
She's awesome.
Yeah, so she's really helping the kids who struggle academically. More of a smaller, double dose is what we like to call it, RTI.
Mm-hmm. And this is one of the grants that one of our curriculum directors, part of her salary, and we're expecting that this is going to decrease, and that's why we took those funds off. So if we stay level, this number could rise because we're no longer apportioning a piece of that salary. So if we don't get a decrease, there'll be more money in there, and then Conway will see a larger piece of that. So on page...
I'm glad to hear your butt sting for Trump. That's good.
Budgeting for Conway.
Yeah.
With my
no, it's good. It's
you,
somebody
so
should be.
Okay, so page 21 is looking at our school choice. And again, last year, if you recall, we stopped spending a year in arrears, and we're sort of spending a year and a half. So we projected that we would have, at this time last year, we projected we would have a beginning balance of minus 52,662 with revenue of 148,737. So what was going to be available was $96,075. And we budgeted some instructional aids there for a total of 164,782. So we would be in the deficit 68,707. If you look in the actual column, we began the year with less of a deficit, 41,613. Our revenue for 16 was 122,395. And right now, our instructional aids are looking like they're going to cost us 140,790. So we'll be spending FY17 money in the amount of $60,008. So when we look at 18, we take that negative and we add the 17 revenue, which we saw on our report earlier, and we would have 111,806 available. And the salaries for the instructional aides that we are projecting for next year is 143,403, which would mean we're spending FY18 money in the amount of 31,597. Does that make sense?
Mm-hmm. Okay. And that's better than what we came into this year.
Mm-hmm. So now this next page, 22 of 23, this is the Special Education Revolving Fund. And what funds this is tuitions from children tuitioned into our WINGS program. So we've added this page so you can see the monies going into the WINGS program. So, and WINGS is the column on the all funding called SPED Revolving. So we had a beginning balance of $104,522. Revenue is up from our projection. Right now we're projecting $288,446. And these are the staff members that are paid from that grant. We have two teachers, a piece of a speech, a piece of PT, which you earlier approved this year. We have instructional aides. This year we had to have a substitute for a temporary placement. And then we have some materials and supplies, field trips, and we have some students that require extended day services. So that would leave the fund at $105,075 at the end of this year. So that becomes our beginning balance in 18. And this is where we start to see a little issue. Four of our students are moving on to sixth grade. So we will only
seventh grade.
So we right now our projection is four tuitioned in students and three Conway residents in the program for next year. So our tuition is down to $137,500, and then we still have these costs to cover. So right now, if we leave it as is, we'll be in the deficit of $2,575. So
And that is this instructional aid, because we have those children moving on, we're overstaffed in wings, so this represents a reduction of an instructional assistant. So even on the first page, you saw that I added it. Once we approve the budget, I will be subtracting that, because this does include the reduction of one instructional assistant. Mm-hmm. Because we don't have the children in the program, there's not a need for those instructional assistants, so through seniority, we will reshuffle the deck.
Where do we see that reduction, Patty?
Well, see how in this year, the aides are 97,000, and next mm-hmm. year it goes down to 82.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. So even, so the 2575, I'm not as concerned at this moment about being in the deficit, because I'm being told by our SPED director that we do have some referrals in the pipeline, so we may be getting an additional 1 to 3 children from other districts back into the program, but because they're not definitive at this time, I feel that this is the best budget to present to you.
So if nothing changes, it's still only $2,575
mm-hmm.
years. But if we build up, the loss of those sixth graders had to have an impact, but if we build up again, we were in discussions today with Karen Ferrandino, and she believes that we'll have 1 to 3 coming. She's had some interest, and that will, again, change things instead of upside down, right side up, and then we'll start all over again with a large balance. And
yep.
More about that.
But boy, when your revenue gets cut in half, I mean, I know it's not like a quid pro quo kind of a thing, but like
mm-hmm.
the only expenses that go down is one instructional assist.
Mm-hmm.
That's pretty tough.
Mm-hmm. So I think that we have to look at it this way, is Conway's students are serviced by this program, yet Conway has never had, the Conway budget, the town appropriation, has never had to really pay for the services that they're getting in. So this program's been self-sustaining, and Conway residents have been able to utilize this. Because we bring the kids in from other towns. We're at the point now where we've got more Conway kids than we do out-of-district kids. So our budget should be taking, because regardless of out-of-districts, we need these placements. We need this program. If we didn't have this program and these children had to go out-of-district, depending on their disability, you're talking $60,000 to $100,000 placements.
Per child.
Per child. So, well, I think we've had a good run, and now, and I don't think we're going to have a deficiency, because there's a need for this program.
Mm-hmm.
We just have to find and market ourselves to the other communities who would rather pay us a smaller fee than having it in another day placement. We don't want our children. We are
and
not allowed.
And the busing down
right.
there and all that stuff.
Chapter 766 approved schools have their own way of funding, just like charter schools. We are not allowed to make a profit, so we're running this at break even. So it's more advantageous for those towns to send us their children than to a private placement. So I think the children will be here, but at this point, I don't want to count dollars that aren't here yet.
Mm-hmm.
And then the last page, 23.
So before
couldn't we?
Since we have so many Conway students in this, couldn't we fund a teacher or something out of our general budget?
You absolutely can. And the reason I didn't want to swing it over
Good
without
question.
You guys seeing it this way is because we're already at a 4.28% increase. I didn't, you know, that's your decision. If that's what you would like me to do, absolutely.
When will we know what referrals we think are coming in for wings? Like,
yeah,
when will that be firmed up?
Right now it's pretty early,
yeah.
And you know, to be planning for next year.
Right.
And
assessments have to be done.
Yes, but not until spring.
Yeah.
We vote, Conway votes in May.
Mm-hmm.
You know.
I'm just concerned if we start showing numbers in the red, then it will put the program at risk.
The program's not at risk.
No, it's not.
There is a need. It's just the balance right now is there's more town resident students rather than out of district.
I mean, if people realize if they don't have the program, their budget will really be at risk.
Right.
So.
But it is kind of, you know, it's a little bit true that the Conway students are benefiting from this program that the other districts are paying for. So it's a delicate balance, I understand that.
I agree with you, Jan.
I just think it's dangerous to run it so low. I think we should fund a teacher or some kind of significant expense that Conway students are using.
So let me just pull up my spreadsheet real quick.
It's hard to say that, though, because we already have the 4.8% increase, but...
And more than likely, we're going to get, I mean, one referral will cover that deficit.
Absolutely.
It will.
You know, one more kid in there.
But we, and I will say this, earlier in the year, I've had a lot of, you know, I had some intense meetings, Kristen, myself, Tracy, Sue, we met and we talked about... Eventually, the goal is to move some things onto the Conway budget. But if this turns right side up, Conway budget, we can't just say, oh, we don't need that money, let's put it back. And we...
And you can't make a profit.
We can't. But the program will never go away.
Right.
Because there's a need for it, and Conway students are using it anyway. But the program won't go away. Because it's so necessary in this day and age. You would know that. We need to have it.
Mm-hmm.
It's just that we just had a bulk. It's just an unusual thing. We had a bulk of kids leave. If they were like two sixth graders leaving to go into, and two fifth graders staying,
right.
We'd be right side up. It's just the way that the exit is all at once.
The timing.
Mm-hmm. And I understand that thinking that the program will go away, but... And I worked really hard to guarantee the people in Wings, it's not going away. It's mm-hmm. part of us, it's part of our district. They might have overstaffed some IAs, but those IAs aren't going to go away because they have seniority. Mm-hmm. So it would just be they would move out and then the new...
Well, and some potentially could move with the kids, couldn't they?
Like they could go if they wanted to, but you know they have to stay in this building because it's a different district.
Right.
This
right.
building they stay because they have
and the
seniority.
Right. The programs at Frontier also that's where we start weaning off the one-to-one support.
Right.
So there may not be any openings at Frontier to follow with the students,
right.
and not all of them will go to Frontier because if they, you know the students that we tuitioned in from Deerfield will go to Frontier, but we have students from other districts. They may not go to Frontier. They
right.
may go to a program in there that it's offered at the middle high school level in their own
right.
district.
Yeah.
Essentially, the program is safe, and I want to make sure that everyone involved in the program know it's safe. It's very safe. It's upside down by 2,000 now. One child, and believe me, that child will come.
What happens if that one child is a Conway child?
Mm.
No, we're saying the 1-3 referrals that we have in the pipeline, Jan, are outside.
Okay, but what happens if we have a Conway child and we're still in a deficit?
It's not going to add
any
money.
Then we have to go and ask for more money.
No, because we're not going to add any more teachers. We're not going to add any more IAs.
Well, you can't say that.
We know who's here. The only risk is a move-in. The only risk is a move-in.
And that's a risk we take all the time.
But that's why we've always kept a small amount, or at least that's the way I feel, that we've kept a small amount in that fund so that if something like that comes up, you're not lost or you know, having to ask the town for more money to fund what we've been, you know, kind of touting as a self-funding service.
Mm-hmm.
How familiar, how intimate are area sped directors and superintendents of the services of the program?
So what we...
How are referrals...
That's a great question.
Is it networking at meetings? In terms of advertising, I would say this is more valuable than
school choice.
Than school choice, because it's such a specialized service.
Mm-hmm. We belong...
I belong to the Franklin County Business Managers Meeting, and about seven months ago, we had a joint meeting where we all brought our SPED directors, and the collaborative CES was there. And what we're working on right now is a database that the collaborative is going to keep for all the programs that the Franklin County schools have within districts. So that if anybody wants to know if you have a, if, does anybody have a program for, you know, K to five, whatever program it is, they're going to go to this website and say, oh yes, Conway Grammar School has that. And then they'll get in touch, their SPED director will get in touch with our SPED director. So we're working on that database right as we speak. And it's also going to try, we're going to try and use that also to help all of us keep our transportation costs down for special education students, because we're thinking of possibly going out. Well, we do share buses right now. We just happen to each get individually charged because they're all different school districts. So we were thinking we could also use this to joint bid our SPED transportation.
Yeah, that'd be cool.
For outgoing and ingoing, it's just a shared pool, you mean? Mm-hmm. That makes sense.
So we are working on that so that all the Franklin County business managers and SPED directors are working together to build this database, and the Collaborative for Education Services has volunteered to develop the database and house the database.
That's cool. Bus companies will hate it, but that
could be
good.
Collaborative is our competitor.
Pardon?
The Collaborative is kind of our competitor.
Yes and no.
Not for elementary.
Not for elementary. No. Mm-hmm. And this is what we're looking at. Yeah. This mm-hmm. is for elementary programs. Mm-hmm. And some of our specialized programs at Frontier.
Right. Because, you know, districts have meetings all the time about, you know, keeping students as included as possible, and when does that decision have to be made to go out? And I hear there's a website that eventually is going to be in the common consciousness of everyone. I don't know if more is... Are we missing referrals by people not knowing about it?
No, they call us all the time.
Okay.
They really do. Tracy, our director, Tracy Prezenko, she's going out to different schools doing site visits when we get a referral. She goes out to the school. She does an assessment of the student to make sure that they're a fit for our program. No, we're very out there.
Okay.
But both... with WINGS and our Horizons program in Sunderland and our LEAP program at Deerfield.
Right.
So all the surrounding towns are very interested in our programs. We've built some really good programs here to keep our children. And it's really for, when we talk about CES, as Elaine said, that's more high school, and they don't do the specialized, where we're dealing with a lot of highly involved children with autism diagnosis. CES has nothing.
And the medical stuff.
And the
medical.
Right, and the medical management
students, amazing.
The medically involved students.
Mm-hmm.
So we're out there.
Okay.
So one more thing I'd like to point out here is that at the end of fiscal 17, we had 105,000 left that we're starting next year with. For fiscal 19, we're going to be starting with
zero.
Maybe zero.
Maybe.
Correct.
Unless that one kid comes.
Yeah.
So
it's hard to count on that.
Right. Well, so Jan, you make a valid point, because and this is the discussion, because do we take a partial hit now and request some of the funding this year, or do we roll the dice and then have to ask for all the funding in FY19?
Well, if we ask for partial funding this year and we got that student in that we're waiting for, then we can still spend from the SPED revolving and not spend from the general budget and turn it back.
So what I've done is I really quickly, I threw the cost of one of the teachers onto our budget, and it would be that we would then be going to town meeting asking for an 8.14% increase.
Really? It does that much?
Yes.
Because we're so
small. Now, we don't have to take a teacher. I can play with some numbers and look at taking a couple of IAs. So again, after presenting the budget, the question is always, are you guys comfortable going to floor at 4.2% increase? What is your pleasure? What is your direction?
Can we see it within the context of the Frontier budget once the assessments on that are done so that we know what the frontier budget increase would be?
Oh, you guys can do whatever you, this is your,
I mean, to me, it's hard to look at them in abstract, like isolated from each other, when you know you have to go and ask for both.
Well, so if you turn the page, if you want to have that conversation, if we look at page 23, this is our enrollments, and look at the block that says frontier percentage comparison, and it says five-year average, you will see that Conway, whatever the assessment, you're going from 15.01% up to 15.86%.
So we're going up.
You're going up. And you're going up the most. On the frontier assessment.
And again, school choice, unknown school choice is an unknown factor in terms of...
Well, school choice, no, we pretty much got our numbers for school choice.
I'm saying about frontier. Yeah. These decisions have to be made by...
Us?
I mean, time period. Like right now, or there are three budget meetings?
We'll be deliberating again in February. And so at this point, what I say is, if you have a direction you want me to take, if you want us to go back and look at some things.
But can I just ask, did you get everything that you wanted in this budget?
I believe... I can't be certain, but I believe this budget contains everything we have right now, minus that one instructional system.
Correct.
So the answer to that would be yes.
All right, because I remember maybe your first meeting with you talked about wanting devices for whatever, and then it was, you know, well, there's a plan and da da da, and yeah.
So the teacher laptops we're going to be able to take care of this year because we have a hardware budget that's going to be able to. Scott Paul has just asked me to wait until April because the new office comes out, so we'd like to do that. So
is that a $12,000 item somewhere?
So we have last year, Scott Paul had presented to you in April. He did an extensive hardware inventory at each school, and then he took the total of value of that hardware and divided it by five, and we put an amount in the budget last year. It's $20,000, so that we're not waiting till everything gets to the end of its life cycle, that every year we've got that $20,000 to keep replacing the items that become obsolete or break down or an emergency repair. We already have those funds. So it sits at $20,000 right now. Before I would recommend cutting that, I think that Dr. Carey and Kristen would have to check with Sue Siegel and with Scott Paul to make sure that we're going to be ready for online testing, because that is the big thing that's coming up.
I don't think Phil was headed that
direction.
Oh,
yeah, I'm not.
Phil's more, what do you need, and let's make sure it's in there. He wasn't trying to cut it out of a line item.
You've been listening to me more carefully over all these years to know better than that.
Jan looks at those angles. She knows the ins and outs.
Because that was the first thing I said, well, let's ask about this, and... She said, no, Phil really, you know...
Doesn't like to give up money.
So, Phil, so we'll be able to cover that. I mean, if I had my real wish list, which I haven't even talked to Lynn and Patty about, but I'd add two additional IAs for next year just because of some needs that I see coming up, which I haven't said to the two of you, so this is you're just asking me what my wish list would be. But so, yes, we would be very happy with this budget.
Can I ask about the substitutes? While we're on this page?
Oh, sure, what page?
So the sped revolving fund, so $21,536, that means that do substitutes in that department get paid more than regular substitutes, or
no.
Have we had one for...
What happened, Ashley, was that we had, they call it a 45-day placement, so we had a student that was a 45-day placement, so we hired a long-term sub because this student needs a one-on-one, and so we instead of making a permanent hiring decision because it was a 45-day placement, we hired a long-term sub to cover. That student is staying with us, but because we knew about next year and the students leaving. We're not going to make it a permanent hire this year. So this sub will be with us to the end of this year. And then next year, one of these other IAs whose student's moving on to seventh grade will take care of this student, and then the substitute, the long-term substitute goes away. So it's a one-year cost only.
So to summarize and edit my understanding, at 4.28%, you're satisfied with everything that's been asked for, and that an IA hangs in the balance as is?
Because the need goes away, the number.
Right, so that hangs on whether one or more referrals come in for wings.
Correct.
Which seem...
Regardless of the referrals coming in, we're still one IA over. So there will be one IA leaving, regardless of the referrals coming in, because we have people staffed that whose students are moving on.
Right.
So if the referrals don't come in, then Kristen would be able to reutilize those in the building as she sees, as she saw fit.
Three out-of-district referrals would be fantastic, but there's no way to plan for that.
Well, we have two in the...
I call it the pipeline.
Currently, from out of district.
Mm-hmm. But it's whether you want to roll the dice on that we're going to cover this deficit and maybe add, so we're not starting next year at zero, or as Jan's raising, should we put something in the budget which raises the number we're asking for at town meeting. To just play it safe.
So if I moved two IAs over to the town appropriation budget, it would increase to 6.85% increase.
Is this what a stabilization account's used for?
No.
These dice rolling? It's a novice question.
No.
So I guess I just want to know what you're...
Usually capital.
I guess I want to know, I would like a direction as to what is your comfort level for an increase to go to the town with. And I know it, Phil's saying, I don't know if I can make that decision until I see what the frontier effect is going to have on the town budget. Is that what you're saying?
Well, yeah, because what my particular question is where Conway was within that five-year rolling average thing, where you get that every fifth year you get that bump, whatever, and if that's this year, and it's going to cause the frontier to be therefore slightly uglier, that number to be slightly uglier, then if it's not, then next year might be more room. I'm trying to, figure out whether, like, the front...
If you look at page 23 again, you'll see that Conway has continually been going up since 12. Mm-hmm. Taking a huge jump last year from 16 to 17, mm-hmm. from 1443 to 1501. So Conway is on the five-year up because your bubble is at frontier. So in another 5 years, it's probably going to be Sunderland's bubble at frontier.
Mm-hmm. Well, if you look at our total salary-related increases, we have 4.17 already. Mm-hmm.
Those negotiated fees. Yeah.
Right.
Well, they're not all. That there is an additional FTE,
which is already hired. You hired her. They hired her this year. That's why we're short in the budget this year. Mm-hmm.
But I just want to point out, no one wants to talk about decreasing positions because it sounds like layoff, etc. But usually you can drop one by attrition if somebody leaves or whatever. There's almost always an IA that leaves.
Except from Conway Grammar School. They don't leave until they retire.
There usually is one. There's usually almost always one.
Back to our school choice policy. Did I hear the number 20 as a level place to rise to?
I think that's an educationally sound number. Especially now that I know the kids better, the teachers, the way the school runs, I think that's a really good number.
There's more room than before, given our dip in enrollment, particularly in the lower grades.
Right, and 20, we were running in 4th, 5th, 6th, you know, 23, 24, those are fine for the upper grades as well.
Right, I'm thinking of the classes with 14 to 16.
I would feel 1 and 2.
Comfortable going to 20.
Right.
With the support that we currently have in the school, yeah. Mm-hmm.
So if you look back on page 1, grade 1 next year is projected to have 17 students, grade 2 and 3 have 15, grade 4 would have 16, grade 5 would have 19, and grade 6 would have 24.
So would school choice take care of this issue? Or no, because it's got to be.
It could be, because if we have more school choice money, there's things on the town appropriation budget we can move over to school choice, and then we can move some of the wings on, or we can move the golfing wings to the school choice. But because school choice is fluid, and we know we want to keep wings, then we move the wings to the permanent budget.
Do the in-class school choice numbers, can they vary depending on the composition of the curriculum?
Yes, yeah. Absolutely. Right. So there's one grade inclusion that we may not go to choice. Yes, yes.
Right.
The tricky part is with the budget is, you're tentative about opening up school choice until you know what staffing you're going to have. So if we know we're going to have this staff, we could open up tomorrow. I think we have a lot of spots filled. But then there's the what if we don't get this budget and we have to cut staff, then do we really want to open the classes to 20? So that's always the unfortunate catch-22.
Mm-hmm. You're saying open for next year or maybe take kids now,
or maybe take a chance and just do it. I mean, like I said, between Lynn and I, we've only gotten 3 calls.
Just for the historical perspective, we're about to celebrate our 250th anniversary. We've had public schools the entire time, and we've never voted down our budget.
Well, where's your beard for the 250th?
Yeah, that's true.
You know, I get harsh domestic feedback when I try to grow a beard. Demands that I get rid of that thing.
Rightfully so.
I get harsh domestic feedback at the possibility of shaving mine off.
Right. I think Patty was starting.
Something's dead on your chin. Get it off.
Patty was starting to go there. Even if we brought in 5 new school choice students this year, that's not FY18 money.
Oh, right. They're asking for next year.
That's for the following year, if we keep our school choice going the way we want to.
Well, we're not spending a year in arrears.
I know. We're almost.
Yeah, we're spending almost. Half a year in arrears.
Yeah. But still, you can't really count on all of that money
and then
for this year.
The other danger about school choice that I just want to is that it's steady income, but our salaries are ever increasing. So when you've got steady income but rises, it's not a good match.
I say we try to keep the budget 5 or under. It just seems like a reasonable number, considering the number that's already not negotiable just from, you know, this contract. But I don't know if that'll then screw us in the future, that we'll then have to have a bigger increase in the future, because...
Any idea what the town's looking at? What increase is it?
I don't know.
I guess they'll tell us next month.
So if we brought one IA over, that would put us at 5.63%, and I'm sure we can find some shavings to get that 0.63 out of there.
That's kind of a random number, but it seems like a tolerable number.
Personally, I think
number.
At least one IA is a good faith effort. I don't think we can just ignore that going down, taking a dip like it did this year.
A reasonable idea.
You know your child better best.
Has it been well over 5% in any of the last 10 years from your recollection?
There was a year.
There was a big year.
There was a year where it was double digit.
Wow.
Prior to me.
Yeah.
I think that has to be prior to me because I don't remember that.
I remember 7 or 8.
7 or 8 with a Frontier double digit as well. That one year where the select board and the finance committee voted,
that was a big
recommended
year.
No.
Well, we had that one special ed student that was sent Frontier skyrocketing.
Oh, yeah.
Get I can just pull up real quickly what we requested last year.
So you'd rather just go and leave it at a deficit?
The 2.5?
368.
2,500? I mean...
It's not a lot of money, but...
But I, you know your town the best. I think 4.28 is pretty healthy.
Yeah.
We have to remember next year, we still have the 2.6, I mean, the 2.5 for, you know, and all those step increases and all the raises and... But on the other hand, we have been talking about moving some of Wings onto the regular budget.
And so maybe this is a little bit of way to start that.
But I'm also in the back of my head thinking about Frontier, which...
Right.
You know.
Right. Well, it is a balance.
It all, because if, I got, in abstract, I think we could come in with a significantly higher than 4.68, and it would still be a likelihood of passing.
No, I totally agree. We could. People support the school, I think, but that's where we're here, is to try to be reasonable and not whatever.
It's a question of like how much you want to antagonize the audience too before you get to the other vote that you need them to approve.
I like your choice of
words, antenna.
Very descriptive.
So in seventh, for this year, it was a 3.68. In 16, it was a 4% increase. And in 15, it was a 3.87.
Oh.
That's all I have on the computer right here.
Yeah.
So my understanding is that Conway is a wonderful town. And they're, like you say, they're very supportive.
They always support their... They're very proud of the school, as they should be.
As they should be, yes. And on the other hand, we do have, what is it, two or three Conway students in the program now?
Two.
Two.
Well, one and a half.
One and a half.
And maybe
And maybe
one next
a whole,
year.
Maybe two and a half next year. So...
Yeah. In the Wings program?
Mm-hmm.
Only two? I thought you said there were four.
One and a half.
One and a half.
That would make it two
right
and a half.
Now,
yeah.
But two yeah, half will go half. Up. That's two, and then we're thinking of a third. I mean,
oh, I'm sorry, because one of our, I'm sorry, Lynn, one of the students in the program is also sixth grade and will be going to seventh grade. Sorry.
So next year we'll have two.
Two and a half.
Well, we don't know about that. Half the IEP hasn't been written.
Yeah.
So two and a half, three, two and a half.
Of eight total?
There'll be four and two and a half. Six and a half chunk of students without the referrals, and then the referrals will bring us to like nine and a half if all three come.
So, having said that, I'm just pointing out that they are Conway children, and Jan made the perfect, you know, maybe. So, if you do move an IA over to the regular budget and bring it up to five something, that would make sense. My heart wants 4.28. Because I'm very conservative with money. I'm very, I'm very conservative with money.
Mm-hmm.
And, but I do understand Jan's point of view, because we are talking about moving some of that Wings over, and there is a certain kind of responsibility piece, not a responsibility piece, but the child lives in the town, that kind mm-hmm. of thing, so.
I think it's reasonable to move one IA over at this point.
I would, first of all, I'm going to support anything you want.
Yep.
That's my job. Yep. And I will support it, and I will speak to it, and I will be very pleased to. So I'm going to go any way you want.
It puts us in a better position, I think.
I would say maybe.
Either way.
Could we hold it open for a month?
Yeah, of course. We don't have to vote on it tonight.
Just to see
I also
how want scary to
just
the assessment is.
Throw it out there. It's going to be a very unpopular idea. But I'm going to throw it out there anyway. But what would your staff look like with one less IA? You know, if you shifted things around.
Right, so...
Just, you know, you don't need time to think about that.
Yeah.
Maybe even... You don't have to answer that right away unless you already...
Yeah, I do. I thought about all the scenarios and what this committee asked. I mean, certainly we do... So the way that we would do it is, currently, every teacher has IA support, mm-hmm. which is... I mean, you do have a phenomenal... school here.
Except sixth grade, right?
Right, and that's partly by choice.
Yeah,
that's entirely by choice.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you. Yeah. So, by reducing.
Sorry, I know him, but
by reducing, and it works. You know, it works. By reducing one, you would have to jigsaw schedules,
mm-hmm.
So an IA wouldn't be attached to a classroom. Mm-hmm. So that would be the difference.
So there's only 5 IAs?
Any other IAs attached to an IEP. Or preschool.
So, but those, but they're wings. Split up, right? They're not attached to a student.
There's the ones in the classrooms?
How many IAs are there total?
14, did we say?
14.
So 15.
5.
15.
There's 15. 5 in the class.
Well, 7. Preschool has 2.
Okay.
Kindergarten has 1. First grade has 1 plus 1 for a child who has an IEP.
Yeah.
Second grade has 1. Third grade has 1. Fourth grade has 1. Fifth grade has 1. Sixth grade has none. The learning lab, and Carol Kirkonos is our special ed teacher, there's 1 in there again attached to IEP support. And
then whatever wing.
So there's several that are kind of placed in multiple places. Their days split. They're not stuck to a teacher or a student, is what I'm saying.
Not now.
No.
They are stuck to a teacher or
Everyone
a student.
We have now is either with a teacher or a student, yes.
A student.
Except for sixth grade.
Okay. I didn't think it was like that.
There's some that we call general ed IAs, and then there's some that are IEP driven. Those are the one-to-one. Mm-hmm. But I see what you're saying. In schools that I've worked in, so I would have 2 second grades, and they would just alter their literacy so that one IA would go in during this classroom's literacy period and then switch over to the other classroom and do literacy there and work off that.
That's a big change. I wasn't really suggesting that.
No, they wouldn't love that. See, we have to remember, too, we're a level 1 school, so the formula we're using is working really well here.
Mm-hmm.
This is a level 1 school, and all our other...
Yeah, no, I wouldn't suggest that. I think what you answered kind of spells out the reasons why we...
And that's the thing.
Well, that'll be a selling point, too, when we want school choice or, whatever, so...
Well, the quality, the product, we're a level 1 school. I mean, the quality's here.
Right.
And so, as I started out saying, we want to maintain that, but we also want to be, fiscally... We're sound, we're servants of the community, and the community is supporting us. So we have to ensure them that we are doing due diligence.
Right.
So these discussions are great, regardless of whether we change ideas or whatever. At least we're reinforcing what we're doing is definitely worth it because of the quality of our product, which is our wonderful statement.
Right.
Your success.
Can I just bring up one thing that really concerned me, I just to think about, and I agree with Lynn, the lower we can keep it, obviously, the better. But if you go back to that wings budget, it's just something to think about with school committee members. This is something that keeps me awake a little bit at night. Every year, they've had that surplus of about $100,000,
mm-hmm.
okay?
Mm-hmm.
So if we go into next year, they're not going to have that surplus of $100,000. Where are we going to make that up? And we're not going to solve it in this budget.
No, that's
but where are we going to make that up? Because if we don't, we're going to have 2 or 3 kiddos that we're going to be sending away for more than $100,000. So just in terms of protecting that program, it's just something to just keep in mind in the future.
Mm-hmm. That surplus has been generated by out-of-district referrals?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Carried over.
Right.
Yeah.
But if we get out-of-district referrals, we'll...
Well, we may make up... The out-of-district referrals have been around 242, 288, so we might make that, but you see we're going to have to make about $300,000 to keep the program
running.
So that's just
right. Nothing
we're going to solve tonight. But.
Well, that's what I'm saying. So the reason I'm bringing it up tonight is the forward thinking. Do we take partial hit in asking for FY18, or do we take the whole hit in FY19?
Right.
So so I'm 50-50, and that's why we need you, do we want 4.28 or whatever, or 5.6?
5.6.
Partial. A little now, a little late.
And you never know, next month we could come back and you could tell us there were two referrals that confirmed it.
Right, so I'm, yeah.
So we'll know more next month.
Thinking about what Ira said, we can certainly, I could certainly talk to Tracy and June about doing more marketing as well. And also, I want you to understand that they don't just take any child, just so you know.
Right, oh, no, it's got to be fit in the mix.
That's why we go out and do the site visits and the assessments.
But a little more marketing.
Yeah, there are kids requiring restraint on a regular basis, we're not, that's beyond our program capacity. Those are for the programs, it's immediate, it's a moderate level of need, yeah.
Okay.
When was the last time, was there ever, since you've been here, a time when the percentage increase at Conway, of Conway, was greater than the percentage increase of Frontier?
I've never compared it, I've never really looked at them closely. I'd have to go back and look.
I would say no, not that I remember.
Well, I mean, because this might be the first year.
I've never been to a Conway town meeting where our budgets were under question, where people weren't going to approve both Frontier or the grammar school.
It's the, and the irony here is the needs of the town.
Right.
It's the needs of the residents of the town. And that's why we're upside down a little bit, just a little bit, by 2,000.
Right.
We're upside down a little bit, but.
And what, you know, and we wouldn't even, let's say we don't get those referrals, Jan, we wouldn't let that go into a deficit. We would have to, you know, tell, you know, don't spend $7,000 on supplies, you're only going to get five. You know, you can't take $1,500 worth of field trips. We might have to, you know, cut that down a little bit.
The program's
You'll be in trouble with Phil if you cut field trips.
As long as I'm superintendent, that program is not going away.
No.
Yeah.
It just is so proactive.
Right. Okay. Any further discussion? And we have our timetable, right? About what happens next with the budget?
It should be in there, yes.
So this is our first look. February, we continue February 16th, that should say.
Yes, it should say 16.
16. And then Finance Committee in February, March, Public Meeting, March 16th, and Town Meeting. Alrighty, so we don't need any vote at this point. And on to reports. Who wants to go first?
I'll be quick because I know the budget has been tiring. People probably have already read over the principal's report, but Sue Siegel did say the two air conditions are better. I attached a school improvement plan update. I'm just going to do that every other month for you so you can see where we are with the school improvement plan. But if anyone has any questions ever, certainly ask or email or whatever you want to do.
How did things go over with the PTO being?
No word, Elaine.
Wow.
Nobody contacted me. People are so willing. I had a parent email me about they want to do a fundraiser for sixth grade to help with the bus for the Red Sox game. I had a parent contact me. She's doing some fundraiser fourth grade to the zoo. So people are doing things. People just aren't interested in coming to meetings.
The meeting.
And, yeah.
That's understandable.
So right now we're going to take the PTO money and put it in the student activities fund and do it that way. But I'll keep bringing it up in my newsletters and stuff.
Yeah, no, that's
great. You don't have a PTO anymore? No, we only had a president. We didn't have, we went to meetings, treasurer reports or anything like that.
It doesn't make any sense.
But just
a few years ago, the PTO was like the thing. There was monthly dancing. There just
it goes on a wave, though.
Yeah, and like I said, people are doing pockets of different things in the school to raise money for certain things, and they're doing great work. But student enrollment, we just got two students from South Carolina, which is exciting.
Good for them.
Yeah,
good for them.
Come north. Yeah. You ever been to South Carolina?
I was starting again today with, my kids are in their 30s, but if I was starting again today,
I ask, you know, what brought you here from, you know, parent was retired military, so that's, they're looking for a great school and sort of, so that's.
Did they buy a house in Conway?
Not yet, but they're going to, yeah, yeah. I don't remember if we talked about the December relocation to Frontier at the last meeting, did we?
Well, it went really smoothly, and we are having the four county, I mean, the four town safety committee meeting next week with all the admin team, and so we're debriefing there. It went really well. Kristen was in constant contact with me. I stayed at the central office because the paper and the TV station, everyone was calling in.
You had to be in your bunker.
We could send it to Lynn.
And then I was making the calls, the robocalls to the families, just so they were aware of what was happening. But my understanding was it was wonderful, and you could speak.
Well, the kids were phenomenal. I don't think kids were good. Frontier staff was, we sent them a fruit basket thing because they were so wonderful to the kids. And
kids had fun.
They didn't want to leave, and it was time to leave.
No, yeah.
And one of the sixth graders said, Mrs. Gordon, your day will be much easier if we just stay here. I said, you're right. How about if you stay here and I go back?
I used to try to sell my kid on Frontier in a few years.
Me too. Like, I was doing that under the auditorium.
See how
I
nice said, that
look
is?
Look at this.
That?
We had the auditorium. Raise your hand if you had a great day. How was the art project? I go, this is your school in seventh grade. And
thank
everyone
you.
Was clapping. And I'm trying.
That's awesome.
Now we'll have to have a fake drill every year.
It was very
good
kind.
Idea.
As Ira said, it was sort of coincident. Yeah.
Oh, we need to work on that idea. That's a great idea.
I'm with you there.
They almost had lunch. They were almost getting
the cafeteria was ready to feed the kids lunch. Darius had everything under control. It was, they were great. And you know, up until then, we've been talking about where we would go. So I called Darius and I said, Darius, could we come over? He said, sure, who's coming? I said, 143 kids and the staff. He's like, absolutely, when? I said, half hour. Sure, come on over.
That's awesome.
You know, I'm not looking for direction or decision tonight, but just something to bring to your attention. So now that I've started taking over the lunch bills, I mean, Patty certainly has offered to help, but she's got so much. But
don't worry about me.
Some people just are not paying.
Mm.
And so I've done a couple letters saying further action will be taken. Yeah, I don't know what that.
Don't make me sick daddy on you.
Yeah. And so I have three kids that are coming to school every day, and they haven't paid for a lunch. And so, again, you don't have to make a decision now, but I've never experienced where kids can just come to school and just keep eating and not paying. And I've taken people to small claims court. You know, I've done it. I don't know. If you want us to just continue to do this, we will, but...
Could I ask that you agree just to not take anybody to court without school committee?
I would never.
Approval?
I'm just saying some of the things that I've seen in the past. Yeah, I would never. Yeah, but I mean, it's gotten because I've seen some schools where they were $10,000 in the hole, and you know what I mean, in other districts, and that's where we had to do the small claims.
I'm sure that you reached out to the parents.
Oh yes, yeah, yeah.
And have you provided them with forms and everything?
Just got a bill last week, I think.
Yeah. And some of those, you know, those we don't worry about. I'm talking about the $500, $600, not the $34 bills. Those are going to get paid.
It was $50.
Yeah. And if you want to
know where you live, like,
what do you want to think about?
The issue with my bill, actually, is when people are coming, have you ever looked at in families in terms of, you know, my kids comes from two households.
Yes.
And so, you know, if he makes a lunch here or doesn't, you know, it's like, okay. You know, and it's ridiculous because I usually wind up paying it because I don't. But I shouldn't be paying for all week. You know what I mean?
Right, right.
But I'm certainly not going to ask the school to divide up the bill on the days that I have the child versus the other person.
Right, right.
But
right.
I'm curious if there's any theme with the families.
I haven't.
If there's, you know, two different households or any, you know, school choice people or any of that kind of stuff going on.
Yeah.
Or if it's just
The higher bills of one family, they are in a divorce situation where it's kind of like, who's going to pay the bill? So I've sort of, okay, put a note, call back in a month. There's a couple families that don't agree with the decision that their child is at free lunch. And I so wish I could do that, but I can't do that, you know.
That's interesting.
I just
so
don't,
I don't
want anyone,
qualify,
I just don't
want
to come to the end of the year and you hear there's a $3,000, you know.
You mean it's a philosophical that kids should have a free lunch? Like,
there are kids that have been on free lunch before and then they change the guidelines so they don't qualify.
Okay.
And again, the $50 ones, the $70, those, we'll clear those up by the end of the year. But we got a couple $700.
What's your solution, Phil?
So I always like the first,
like
the first letter that goes out, whatever, the first couple. But then, like, the second or third letter that goes out has a handwritten little note on the back from the principal saying, we can't let the, you know, something.
And then I call.
And then a phone call.
That's all been ignored?
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah, I'm talking about the families that have all,
You've called and they still ignore it?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Now.
And then, I'm okay with a letter threatening litigation, too.
Or further action will be taken.
Yeah.
I don't know what the further action is.
So what I've done in other school districts at this point is that I would send the letter and ask them to call me to set up a payment plan.
That's a good idea.
I've done that, too.
Yeah. And see if I get a response, because sometimes, because they don't know me, so sometimes I can be, you know, well, I understand that's your philosophy, but we really do need our money in order to keep feeding your child, and
you can't.
We don't ever refuse to feed a kid, but we can make sure that they're just receiving a cheese sandwich and not the hot lunch entree.
Right.
The thing about that is that when it's a situation where someone was formally qualifying for free lunch, and then I guess
somebody randomly,
I mean, they could be
the
$1 over the limit and they wouldn't qualify anymore.
I know.
And
I know.
That's a little bit different. And I'm the true bleeding heart, but. I would be more inclined to let stuff like that slide than.
But the problem is, Phil, is if there is a deficit, then we have to pay that money. If we get to the end of the school year, the school committee has to find money.
Yeah,
in
we
this
vote on
budget
it every year
to make the fund whole. So we're going to be subsidizing the people who are refusing to pay. And is that really fair to the people who are paying?
I'm like, if they ignore Kristen's phone calls, I say they go on to.
If it's a situation where they truly
can't
afford it.
I've got about seven people with really, really high bills who have said, I said, anything, $20 a week, something to get this down, and I just get nothing. You know, I have a nice conversation, I get nothing. Or I have two who insist they should be free lunch. I've had them redo the forms. I've sat with them to make sure they're doing it right. And like I said, and I'm okay keeping going like this, but just, I don't, being new, I don't want you to come at the end of the year and you say, Krista, why do we have $2,700 of unpaid, you know?
If they don't qualify for free and reduced, do they qualify for reduced?
No, not any of the people that I'm dealing with, yeah.
So
one family, like the spouse got a job, it's like a minimum wage job, and that put the family of three kids over, you know. I don't agree with it either. I want to scream, but.
So the question I have is, how does the committee feel about the cheese sandwich alternative?
It's appalling.
Terrible. I think it's appalling.
I know.
Feed the kids.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah.
Okay. Feed the kids. That's easy. The food here is really delicious.
Yeah. The kids shouldn't
to be
suffer.
Not, the kids shouldn't be humiliated.
Thank you for that. Because I've worked in other districts.
No.
No.
So, no, really, thank you for that. Mm. And I'm fine. Like I said, I just didn't want to come in June being a new principal.
Yeah.
Mm,
yeah, well, Frontier, you know, that's a consideration there.
How long of a period of time is that? Is that 1 year, 2 years?
See, and I have a kid that hasn't paid for lunch in 3 years.
3 years.
No.
See, I would
kidding.
Draw the line there.
No, and this one won't return my calls. I've sent a certified letter. It's been 3 years.
Hmm.
I'd be okay with listing names on bulletin boards, listing names that people would always make. But
that'd be awful.
It's better than suing them.
We do that for taxes.
Yeah, we do it for taxes. It's the exact same thing.
Oh, it's checks. You see that in the store.
Yeah. That's what everybody when they go to the post office, first thing they do on the way out the door, you look to see who you know it's on the tax default list. Yeah.
Oh, no. What? Is this a town thing?
Yeah. We post, the town posts the people that don't pay their taxes.
Do this another time?
Mm-hmm. I've seen that.
Yeah, it has to be posted in two public places before you can put a title on it.
In Hoyle, they take out an ad in the paper, so it's even worse because it's in the Springfield paper. Here's the people who will water, sewer.
As soon as it's Hoyle, you have to. Yeah. It's by law. If you're going to put a lien on the house, then you have to advertise.
Oh, wow.
It's a really good thing. I'm all for that.
All right. Is that it?
Yes.
Okay. Lynn?
I'll just direct you to my superintendent's message on the Frontier Union 38 front page. But it's about how school delays and school closings are decided.
Have you been getting a little flack, have you?
No.
Oh, good.
I have gotten some great comments.
Oh, good.
I agree.
I meet with the unions and this and that. So I met with the IA union reps from the buildings yesterday. And they were like, you would not believe. In Deerfield Elementary, they were like, singing your praises. You know,
yeah, they
called
yeah.
the night before. So
I agree.
Plan.
I love
we
that.
You know what's going to happen. And so, and then I text the principals, and I have a bitmoji that.
Yeah, it's cute. Yeah, yeah.
Let's hope that I didn't, you know, call it too soon, but it didn't. Because half of my colleagues, and it'll tell you, I work with 9 other superintendents. I go on the NOAA site. We follow the trajectory of the storm. Any advisory or warning, I take seriously. And so we did have an advisory for Wednesday morning. So I do take that from NOAA. My road crews, I text them, you know, I texted them the night before. And I waited until 8:30, which I don't like to call it after 8, but I really struggled with it because we just weren't sure how much ice, how much snow, whatever. But I did call it, and it was a good call, but half of my colleagues decided to wait until morning. And I really feel my families, they need to know as soon as possible.
Great.
They need to plan. They appreciate it. And if there is any human way possible, I'd like them to know the night before. So so my bitmoji this time is,
yeah,
first of all, 2-hour delay.
Yeah,
and it looks like me. You can design
the
emoji
yeah.
to look like
yes.
you, and
that's awesome.
Let's hope it doesn't, you know, blow up in my face.
Mm-hmm.
But and sure enough, 4 o'clock next morning, they keep, you know, we go on, and they're like, one school closed, but that was because they had an early release, and
mm-hmm.
so, and whereas I would change the early release, they couldn't.
Yeah,
and everybody else called in the 2-hour delay, but they had to do it at 5 o'clock in the
right.
morning and wake everybody up. And I just was like, okay. Not that I still was awake, but I knew my families were prepared.
Yeah, totally.
Yeah, that's great.
And I really like them to know. But the whole shoot match is on the Frontier page. That was my January message. I do a new message every month, and I put that one on this month just to help people know that I do take it seriously, and I understand the inconvenience of a 2-hour delay. And or closing, but I do like them to be prepared the night before as much as possible.
Yeah, that's great.
So that's all I have.
There was one year when at Frontier where Marty called school off and it like blew over. I mean, it was like windy and people were so mad, but the reports were like.
Yep.
It was going to be whatever, and it just somehow missed us, and people were like, what the heck, and da-da-da-da-da. And then there's another time when every other town was fine, and Conway was a mess.
Mm-hmm.
That happens
and
more often than not.
And that's always my fallback when I call.
Yeah,
I always know Conway's going to
yeah.
have it rougher. But I will tell you, the part of the reason is because somebody had said, when we had the 2-hour delay because of the wind chill, because it was so cold, they said, you know, one day, so on a Friday, I called a 2-hour delay because of the wind chill with the low temperatures. And then Monday, they said, well, it was just as cold Monday. But the difference was you didn't have that combination with the wind chill.
Right.
And so when I think about high school students out there in the dark at 6:30 in the morning, with that, the temperature and the combination of the wind chill, what happens is that those particular details on that Friday would have caused frostbite within 10 minutes.
And they don't wear coats and shorts on.
Yeah, they don't wear coats, right. Their brain cells, yeah.
So I wanted the 2 hours for them, for the roads to warm up, for the wind, you know, the sun to come out, be daylight, and they, you know, would have a little bit more chance of being warm. But it wasn't just because it was cold. And I said that to the people on my robocall, but they're like, well, it was cold Monday. We didn't, you know.
Yeah. I didn't hear any nonsense.
But anyway.
And the move has gone well? You're all settled in?
Please come and visit. Phil's been to my office several times. I don't think we've been down far into the, but Phil's been in, and it's very, very smooth.
I love what you've done to the place.
I hate it. 6 hours of planning, six months of planning, and it came off without a hitch. I gave everyone the time off on the moving day. I unpacked 40 boxes in our combination room, so the teachers, the bookkeepers, and the accountants, and everybody coming just had their own stuff to unpack. We bought used furniture. So we originally estimated like 90,000 to move. In the end, I don't even think it was 40.
Wow.
So we did a beautiful job in Pioneer. Pioneer School District is coming tomorrow. They saw it before we moved, and they're coming tomorrow to tour it again. The assistant superintendent and their facilities person.
Cool.
There was a district in Franklin County that moved to the cellar of their middle school for 800,000 or 600,000, I can't remember, 100,000. I think it was 800,000. We spent 40,000, 40, 50, somewhere in that area.
Yeah, and the old building is just sitting there.
No, I am going to request at the Frontier meeting that we put together our, again, our relocation subcommittee and really discuss what we really want to do for that building.
Yeah.
I can't make that decision alone, so I know it. Now everybody's
out.
We only had one entrance egress. We only had one egress in that building. We'd be jumping out the window.
Yeah.
There was just so many things that, you know, were not, you know, in compliance. We were ADA, you know, people had hurt themselves. They'd have to go up and downstairs to the bathroom. Couldn't have meetings there if somebody was, you know, disabled. So this was the best move. It wasn't my decision to move. It came my first day on the job. I went right to the meeting, but it came out, and it came out well.
Yeah, that's awesome.
People are adjusting well, so I'm very pleased.
That's awesome.
And thanks.
Great. Ashley, do you have a collaborative report?
No.
Okay.
I don't. I need to. Yeah, I fully intend to go, but I've kind of been a single parent with all the trains falling off the tracks.
Okay.
And my babysitter is in the Bahamas.
Oh, okay.
So, yeah, kind of
fun. Well,
so
I could go.
Babysitter sounds good.
I can cover it sometime, too, if we need to. Okay.
Yeah.
All right. Can I have a motion to adjourn?
Motion.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.